Hey everybody, I just want to take a moment to talk about a new thing I'm doing. Over the years, many of you have reached out to me telling me how much you love the podcast, but also wish there were more personalized takeaways and more in-depth interactions with our guests to hear what they think about comedy. This is why I'm now launching my new digital academy, Blueprint for Success. With exclusive interviews and comedy philosophies of stars and industry veterans, personalized versions of the industry standard podcast, commercial-free, and one-on-one coaching time with me. Blueprint for Success will give you the powerful tools that will take you up the elevator beyond the competition and reach the highest possible levels to achieve your dreams. Whether it be stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, hosting, radio podcasting, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or an agent. Now I'm here to help, personally. We'll go on an express train of comedy and entertainment like nobody else has before. You can find out more about Blueprint for Success and the comedy business on my website at barrykatz.com. Together, we'll take your career where you want it to go.
Harvey Weinstein's a very complicated character. Was a very large part of my life. He was my boss for a long time. And I worked for him for a long time. And then I also made a lot of movies with him that he financed. And I always knew he had demons. You know, I always knew and saw that he was, you know, quite capable of quite dastardly deeds. Just in general kind of business acumen. And knew that, you know, he was a very rough customer, but I now come to know that I, you know, didn't know the half of it. And that's a very, very troubling thing to know that someone that you were around this much was capable of, you know, causing a lot of damage. I didn't know the half of it.
Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. It's so great to have you here. Thank you so much for everything. You guys are amazing. The response, so great. I'm so, so unbelievably grateful to all of you. You are incredible. Your messages, how you pass the podcast along to everybody. It's truly humbling. Thank you. And before I get started with episode number 2 of Richard Gladstein, I just want to let you know if you need to reach me, you can do so at Barry Katz on Instagram or Twitter or at barrykatz.com on any social media platforms. Just follow me and I would be glad to get back to you as soon as possible. And I just want to let you know that I just recently got the call from the New York Comedy Festival that I will be bringing this podcast, Industry Standard, to the Stand in downtown New York City on Wednesday, November 6th at 7 p.m. You can get tickets at the New York Comedy Festival website or the Stand website, and I'd love to see you down there. Got a really great special guest that I'm going to announce soon, and I'd really love you to make it. And when I think about Richard Gladstein, I think about patterns and how patterns, when you look at them, they truly say it all. I think Bill Parcells in the NFL once said, "Your record is who you are." It doesn't matter. If you lost the game, you lost the game. If you won, you won. And that's your record. It doesn't matter if something happened or it was a fluke. Your record is your record. And when it comes to Richard Gladstein, let's take an analysis of 3 things. Number 1, do geniuses want to work with you? Well, Quentin Tarantino decided to work with him 4 times. 4 times. And the films that he worked with him on were great films. Reservoir Dogs, The Hateful Eight, Jackie Brown, and Pulp Fiction. I think that says it all. If a genius wants to work with you again and again and again and again, it lets you know that you're doing something right and you know how to make that person feel safe. Number two, recognition from your peers. Richard Gladstein's films have received 25 Academy Award nominations and won 5. Think about that. The guy's been associated with films that have gotten those kind of accolades, whether he worked as an executive or an executive producer at a company, or if it was at his own company, Film Colony. The bottom line is, again, his peers, not once, not twice, not three times, multiple times, his peers recognized him or his films. 25 Academy Award nominations for films that he was associated with. 5 of those won an Academy Award. Financial success through your hard work and through what you bet on and the bold moves you make in your career. The total accumulated worldwide theatrical box office receipts of all of the films that Richard Gladstein has been associated with are over $1 billion. Again, not once, not twice, but multiple times, his movies or movies that he's been associated with have made over $100 million and combined $1 billion. Take those three things and add the fact that this guy is an incredible philanthropist and gives back to some great, great charities that help people across the world. And I'm telling you, if you can figure out how to get geniuses to work with you multiple times, if you can figure out how to do the kind of work that your peers recognize over and over again, and then if you can convert that hard work and relationships into financial gain, and if you take the time to give back to your community or to charities that mean something to you in the world, I can pretty much guarantee you that you'll have the possibility of the kind of career that Richard Gladstein has.
Here we go in 3, 2.
This show will have laughter.
I got everybody pregnant with Barry Katz and semen.
I'm not comfortable with the tone this is taking.
If you're undeniable, you will not be denied.
If you want to be successful in show business, you get yourself a Jew white manager like Barry Katz.
Being a manager is just turning no's into yeses.
Creating holy shit moments.
Undeniable.
You f***ing firing me up, Katz.
I love this man.
Is there anything else I should know?
You're on.
What?
Now I'm on the air!
Barry Katz.
Back in the house.
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 Let's do this.
Did you watch films when you were a kid that inspired you? Was there a television series that you loved? Did your father bring you to the old dollar movie theater and say, hey, let's watch this together?
I think when I was in my junior year, I kind of had to declare a major. And I declared communications without great clarity of what that meant or where I was going. And as I began to go through that, I found my way towards film school. And I always had a great affection for films. I never thought of it as a career. I never thought that I could make that choice. For some reason, I didn't feel that that was... I didn't even know you could study that, really. I didn't know that you could sort of make that choice in a way. And as I made that choice, it was because I had an affection for it and an interest in it. It wasn't throw a dart at a board, but it was close. And through that process, I think the studying of story and storytelling was really appealing to me. So the thing that I love about movies and why I went into it was I like theme and character. Plot is not that important to me. So when you watch a movie like To Kill a Mockingbird, and it asks the question of, you know, if you put yourself into these person's shoes, what would you do? And it asks the question of, you know, as they talk about, you know, why would anyone harm a mockingbird when a mockingbird does nothing but bring goodness? I.e., how could you put Boo Radley through a trial when he will not be able to go through that. And a better version of justice is to just create an alternative tale and let that be. You know, that's the morality of the movie. That concept of sort of telling a story that has a moral, a certain morality and lesson of what characters go through to, is what is appealing to me. The plot you can invent, I feel you can invent any plot you want to service a theme or character. So that's what I'm driven towards. So some of the movies that I've made are heavy thematically, I think. So a movie like The Cider House Rules asks the audience a question or a series of questions. You know, whose rules are you going to choose to live by? Is what The Cider House Rules is about. Where do you belong in the world? And as you travel through, are you going to create the rules for yourself, or are you going to abide by someone else's rules? And that then comes down to questions of abortion and various other events and incidents. And similarly, the Bourne Identity asks, you know, the movie asks you, you know, as Jason Bourne, am I a good guy or a bad guy? That's the whole movie. Oh, should I work for the government? I must be a good guy. Oh, should I work for the government and I'm a bad guy? That's the whole movie. Every scene is that. So that question, which every good movie asks a question, and a great movie answers it in an interesting way that you didn't anticipate. That's what I like. You know, so, you know, Finding Neverland asks you, like, I'm not such a great fan of Peter Pan. You know, Finding Neverland is the story of Peter Pan. The guy wrote Peter Pan. But I don't care about Peter Pan. Finding Neverland is a story about where do you find inspiration? Where do you find imagination? And that's what the film asks and hopefully answers. And along the way, he writes Peter Pan.
Has there ever been an extraordinary film that you've seen that doesn't ask or answer a question?
Well, Quentin movies fall into a whole nother bag of movie making, because I don't even know what half the movies that he makes are about. I don't really know. And usually I'm pretty good at when I teach, I go, name a movie and I'll tell you what it's about. But if you do that with like Pulp Fiction, it's a little difficult. You know, yes, you can go, you know, it's a tale of loyalty and betrayal. Okay. You know. But it with Quentin movies, it's significantly more difficult to do, because it isn't as... the theme of the movie isn't as important as the depth of character and goodies that they go through. So it's a different experience. It's a different... you go to a Quentin movie with different expectations. Or I do, anyway. Go with a different set of expectations.
Do you find movies that are directed by the writer to have a chance of being better than ones that are directed by somebody who isn't the writer?
I don't think I don't think that you can point to that films that are directed by the that are written films that are directed by the writer are necessarily better or not. I think you can sometimes feel when it's a mess and there's been 10 writers. You know, that's the flip side. I think some of the... I often ask writer-directors, if you had to choose, which one would you be? Like, if you ask Paul Thomas Anderson or Quentin Tarantino or, James L. Brooks, which comes first? It's usually the writing. But if they had to choose, they'd be a director because they couldn't live without making the movie. That's usually the answer. But it's all about the script. So I think that the great writer-directors are seamless between writing and directing. And I think that's the case with like Paul Thomas Anderson and Quentin, is that they have created their story and then they take their writer hat off and then they direct the movie and they solve all of the problems and all come from a filmmaking directorial view. And that's why they're so good, is that they were the writer and now they're the director. And I've made movies where the writer shows up to direct the movie, but the director never showed up and the writer was there the whole time. And those movies don't work out very well because a writer is not a good director. A director has to be the director. But in the case of like Paul or Quentin, they are so equally skilled at all of it that, but I can imagine that when, at least with Quentin, when he's directing, you forget that he's the writer. It's not he because of the way he's working. It isn't studying the script. It isn't, that part already happened. Now there are actors. Now there's a camera. I mean, I don't think he would ever direct something he didn't write. I don't think either of them would. But that's because they are so seamlessly the writer and the director. But at different times.
You've been in, let's say, 25 premieres. You've been at 25 premieres where the movie has been cut, put together, is about to go in the theaters, and friends, family, people in the industry come, 1,000 people sometimes, to see your movie, and you're there. When the credits roll, out of those 25, what percentage in your mind did you say to yourself, this is going to do really, really well? And what percentage did you say to yourself, we're in deep shit here? And how often were you right and how often were you wrong?
I think when you're having the premiere, you know whether the movie's going to work well or not.
Before the audience responds, really?
Well, by the time you get to the premiere, you've had test screenings. You've shown it to audiences. That's not your first blanch at seeing people watch your movie. When you go to a premiere, you already have reviews. The premiere is not, I think, if you don't mind, a better question is when you're kind of done with your movie, or you've watched a cut of your movie, and you go, and you kind of have a sense of what it's going to be, do you know if it's going to work or not? Like, because you have to go a little earlier than the premiere. You know too much at the premiere. You know how many theaters you're going to be in. You know your release date. You know
the reason why I asked that, because about a year ago, Sandler at the premiere, and was so excited at the beginning of the premiere, and after the premiere, he was down, and he was like, I don't know, Barry. I don't know, man.
I think that's a bit of bullshit, because you know. First of all, a premiere is the most normal audience reaction to your movie. Like, there's half of it's like agents and friends. Like, it's not a real environment to test your movie. When you take your movie into like Poughkeepsie and throw it up in a theater for 500 people, you know how people there, you go, you're crushed or you're elated.
Well, I like your question better than mine. So how would you answer your question?
I think you have to have, there's measures of success. You know, and the box office has never been a huge measure of success to me. Like, that doesn't really tell you the whole thing. Because there's the release date, there's the, you could be like this critical this, or you could. So I think, you know, probably half. I think it's hard because it's your movie. So you're probably not the best judge of it. Because inevitably, like when you're sitting home like 10 years after the movie's been made and you're hanging out and you're flipping channels and all of a sudden you see one of your own movies pop up, and you have to watch it for 10 minutes. Like, if you're flipping around, you don't know what you're doing, and one of your movies is on, you watch it for 10 minutes, 5 minutes, sometimes longer. Like, sometimes, like, if it's good, you might hang out for an hour. But you're going to spend 5 minutes, even with the crappy ones. And you watch them and you go, oh, God, what were we thinking? All the time. Oh, why didn't we cut that out? Oh, I remember that. That would have been so easy. Why didn't we go from this to this? And really, we let her wear that? What were we thinking? I'm like, oh, God, that music cue was terrible. So I think you have to give the movie away. You know, like, you make the movie, you pour your heart and soul into it. Is the movie what you wanted it to be? And some movies are definitely what you wanted them to be. And some movies are compromises and didn't come out the way that you had hoped they would come out. But it's a long process of getting to that point. And you usually know beforehand, the making of the movie wasn't that much fun. Boy, this is painful. Yeah, I kind of like it, but it's really flawed. Or, I love every inch of this movie, and if anyone criticizes it, I'll kill them. So you can have both, because it's your baby. And sometimes you can see your baby clearly, and sometimes not so much.
Hey, everybody. I hope you're enjoying this episode as much as I am. If you made it this far and you haven't fallen asleep yet, then you must be the type of person who's serious about having a career in the comedy business. That's why I'm offering you my blueprint for success, a one-of-a-kind all-access pass into my knowledge and experience after over 40 years of working with the best of the best in this crazy entertainment industry. I'll tell you all the stories, all the philosophies, give you all the great special guests, and even give you one-on-one private consultations to help you expand, enhance, and skyrocket your comedy career. Just go to barrykatz.com and click on Blueprint for Success to learn more about my groundbreaking digital academy that I've created just for you. With it, we can take your career so far that one day, instead of listening to this podcast, you'll be interviewed on it.
Hey, everybody, and I wanted to thank some of the sponsors on the podcast, starting with Aqua True. If you haven't bought this countertop water purification system, you have to do so. It's incredible. It turns tap water into your favorite bottled water instantly. It saves you thousands and thousands of dollars. It gets rid of all those plastic bottles that you have in your trash. Thousands and thousands of listeners have bought these. Everybody loves it. Not one complaint. It's incredible. I haven't bought a bottle of water in years since I got this, and you won't either. And if you go right now to industrystandardwater.com and type in the promo code Barry, you'll immediately get $100 discount. $100 discount, and start enjoying the best and most cost-effective water you've ever had. I guarantee it. Lastly, the air doctor. I don't know what the air inside your house is like, but the air inside my house, it feels heavy at times before I got this product. And now it got rid of all the bad air in my house, the dust, the pet hair, the pollen. It just gets rid of all the contaminants circulating through your home. And for me, when I got this product, it was amazing the difference that I found in the air in my house. And it's normally $600, and you can check Amazon right now and you'll see. But for all of you listening today, I can offer you $300 off. $300. Just go to airdoctorpro.com and type in the promo code Barry. That's airdoctorpro.com, promo code Barry, and save $300 and get rid of all the bad toxins in your house and start breathing the cleanest and healthiest air in the world.
6 degrees of separation.
All right, 6 degrees of separation. I'm going to mention some names. Tell me what comes to your mind. Bruce Willis.
Man.
Tim Roth.
Brilliant.
Uma Thurman.
Strikingly bold. Like, she just is who she is, and she is a presence and a great strength of person.
Samuel L. Jackson.
He's one of the most sort of entertainingly distinct. When we were doing The Hateful Eight, I said to him, he was had just done one of these great long monologues, and he came out, and I was sitting outside, and I just said, look, as a fan, like, to watch you do that was so satisfying to me, that long, like, two page, you know, it was like 3 minutes of, I'm so satisfied having just watched you do that. I can't thank you enough. Like, I just loved watching you do that, and thank you. And he goes, wait till Thursday when I get to do. And he did this, the three pager from that he's going to have to do in a week, right in my face.
Wow.
And without missing a beat. And it was one of the, I was practically crying, because you just watched a master performer. And he loved it. He just loved that he knows it, and he loves doing it. And so he just loved doing it. And he didn't care, like, okay, this is for the camera and will be for all time in the movie. Or I'm doing it, like, in the backyard, sitting on a picnic table. It didn't matter. He loved it. And you saw that.
Matt Damon.
So smart and very dedicated and just like a good, normal person.
Mickey Rourke.
Whack a donut. But a really emotional, wounded guy who's had a kind of a three lives in one. And has gone through all sorts of craziness in his life, and has lived more life than almost anyone I know, and wears it, and lives it, and feels it, and it comes out of him. And actually a really good guy.
Harvey Keitel.
Harvey Keitel was one of the first sort of like movie stars that I ever met. And we became friends. He was at my wedding, you know, about 25 years ago, whatever that was. And was my first kind of actor that I became friends with and got to know and worked with. And it taught me a lot and was a great kind of a presence in my life for a really long time.
Johnny Depp.
Just extraordinary guy, you know, that when we did Neverland, you know, the movie relies on the audience looking behind the eyes of this guy and wondering what's going on in his head. That's the whole movie. Like, you zoom in on him and you go, what is he thinking? And then we dramatize shit that he's thinking or imagining. And so you have to cast an actor who you want to know what is going on in their brain. And there were some actors where you go, you know, when you pull in and you push into that guy, I don't really want to know what's going on in there. It's not that interesting to me. And with Johnny, you want to know what's going on. Like, there's always, I always find there's great, when you're casting somebody, like, you have to ask yourself a certain question. Like, I remember with the Cider House Rules, the Michael Caine part is like, this guy is a gynecologist in the movie. So you have to ask, would you like this guy to be your gynecologist? So you go, so you're trying to cast the role of Michael Caine. You go like, okay, well, how about, I remember someone said, well, how about we cast, you know, Robert De Niro. I think Robert De Niro is brilliant. I'd like to make any movie with Robert De Niro. I don't know if you really want Robert De Niro as your gynecologist. Like, that's not the most comforting concept is, Robert De Niro is going to be, there's a lot of other things you'd like Robert De Niro to be in your life. You probably don't really want him to be your gynecologist.
Ving Rhames.
He was like just a powerhouse, you know, just you hear that voice, and the guy was just like, who is this guy? Where did this guy come from?
Dustin Hoffman.
Dustin Hoffman is one of the most generous, authentic, gifted, kind, dedicated human beings I've ever met. And is such a touching soul that there are few that are as kind and warm and generous as he is.
Mark Forster.
He's a wonderfully gentle human, fun, loyal, good guy.
Lasse Hallström.
Is the for me the movie that I made that I was involved with making that is the most personal to me is The Cider House Rules, and that's largely because of the process of having worked on the script for so long and then finding Lasse to direct it and being what a great just collaborative partner he was, and just a great guy, just funny, warm, and I think like Quentin in a way, like directing is just what he needs to do with his life. Like this is what he was born to do and is so skilled at it.
Sean Penn.
Sean Penn, I've made several movies with him. Hurley Burley, which he was in, and we kind of pretty much produced together, I would say. Though he didn't take the credit, he should have. And I was a producer of The Crossing Guard, which he directed. And he just is a brilliant human being. And a kind, funny, crazy, distinct. He is who he is, and he's a wonderfully brilliant guy.
Diane Lane.
Diane Lane is one of the most charismatic, wonderful, genuine. Well, I feel like I only have good things to say about people. Great. Just lovely human being.
Hey, everybody. Let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from Industry Standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business. I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable. So just go to barrykatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.
Harvey Weinstein.
Harvey Weinstein's a very complicated character. Was a very large part of my life. He was my boss for a long time. And I worked for him for a long time. And then I also made a lot of movies with him that he financed. Very complicated guy who obviously has demons, and I always knew he had demons. You know, I always knew and saw that he was, you know, quite capable of quite dastardly deeds, just in general kind of business acumen, and knew that, you know, he was a very rough customer, but I now come to know that I, you know, didn't know the half of it. And that's a very, very troubling thing to know that someone that you were around this much, and who, again, as I said, like, you knew was, you know, not on the up and up in a lot of ways, and was capable of, you know, causing a lot of damage. I didn't know the half of it. And that's, and obviously he caused considerably more damage, I think, than I knew, but that a lot of people knew that he was capable of.
Your proudest moment in show business?
Well, I'd like to think I haven't had that yet, but I think making the Cider House Rules was probably, for me, one of the most satisfying experiences, because I, you know, found the story and nurtured it with John Irving, the writer of the novel who wrote the screenplay. We spent years, 5 years together, working, you know, 35 drafts of that screenplay and creating this movie. The movie is exactly what I hoped it would be. And it looks and feels and exists exactly in this dream that I had. Like, that, it just happened. Like, I wanted to tell this story. We got the right amount of money, the right director, the right actors, the right composer, the right edit. I look at that movie and I feel, you know, like I said before, like, if you produced The Hateful Eight or I did, the movie would be the same thing. And that's not saying I didn't work hard and contribute, but your role is not, like, it's not really reflected in what the movie you're watching is. It's other things, that, in the way that you supported Quentin to make the movie. The Cider House was, I don't think the movie wouldn't exist, and if I hadn't done what I did. And so you feel a greater sense of, again, ownership. I got to come up with a different word, a greater sense of what, how you contributed to that movie. And so it, that and Neverland are movies that you just nurture from its inception, from its embryo, to its, you know, poster in the theater.
Your biggest disappointment in show business, and how you used it to fuel yourself to the next level?
I think right now I'm trying to kind of figure out what is a kind of a next chapter, if you will, like a kind of a third act, if you will. And I'm in the midst of creating a new film school in China, in Beijing. And there's a company called Mountaintop, which is a very, very successful talent and management agency in Beijing. And I'm working with them to create this new school in Beijing. And I'm really excited about it. It's going to be not a school that offers degrees, not a bachelor's degree or a master's degree, but will be like 4 to 6 month really intensive workshops that culminate in the making of a short film. And I'm really excited about creating that school from nothing. We're just working it out now. And that's really exciting. And so I'm trying to figure out how to do that and do it well and whatever else I do. I don't know.
So your biggest disappointment is where you perceive, whether it was a month ago, a year ago, or whatever it is, was the end of certain chapter that you felt for yourself, and now that fueled you to open the thing, the school in Beijing. But there always has to be something that happens that's bone crushing, that sort of you have to get over and get to the next level. You didn't have anything like that?
I think, you know, the bone crushing, I don't know, but soul searching, and is, I love making movies.
Like, there was never a movie where you killed yourself putting it together and it comes out and you ask somebody, did you see the movie? And they say, oh, I was busy that day.
You have a million of those. I think more is I'm in a place where I have to figure out kind of career-wise, you know, feature films, the kind of movies that I've made that I like the most, these kind of like $20 million dramas, like The Cider House Rules and Neverland. Those movies are not being made today. or they're being made as television series. And so navigating this sort of transition that this kind of world of independent filmmaking is now, you know, Netflix and Amazon and stuff. So I have a couple TV things that I'm trying to do that are adapting to that world, if you will. But it's also, I think, a time to figure out, like, what do I want to just go produce another movie or TV show? I don't really want to. I'm not desperate to do that. What I am trying to figure out is how to create a different sort of legacy, likely in film education, that is a more lasting, bigger thing than making a movie.
Got it. Last question. What advice do you have for the young person growing up in the Bronx, really doesn't have an idea of what they're supposed to do or their place in life, and they navigate through, they get into school, and they figure out it's this business, and how do they go about having the kind of extraordinary career that you're having? And then as a part two, you can do it before or after. You've seen so many incredible actors and directors and writers. Also, I think it'd be nice to know, what advice do you have for the young people in those genres as well to get to the next level?
I think in a way the answer is the same for both of these, which is that filmmaking is an art and a craft that you learn. And by reading a lot of stories, by developing your own taste, by creating your own stories, by having confidence in your own point of view, is, I think, what people need to have. And I think, like, filmmaking is not about, like, where you put the camera and, like, this great shot, or like, you have to be a storyteller that is bigger than the shot or the camera or the lens or the, whether you're on Netflix or you're in a theater, like, all that shit doesn't matter. And I think one has to develop, expose yourself to literature, movies, art, read, study, and over the course of time, you will develop your own distinct voice. And then you apply that voice. That's what it's all about. And there's no shortcuts. There just aren't. They don't exist. And, you know, you hear all the time, well, God, I'm a, like, I want to direct a movie. And it's like, you know, every director that you like or you don't like, they were a first-time director once. Like, it actually does happen. It's like your virginity. You're going to lose your virginity. It's going to happen. Right? Some people it happens at 15, some people it happens at 25. And like, every director was a first-time director. Every writer was a first-time. Every producer was a first-time producer. Like, so when you think it's not going to happen, you realize that it has happened for every one of those people. They lost their virginity at some point. So, like, just keep working and you'll lose your virginity. You'll be fine.
This has been amazing. Thank you so much.
You're really good at this. It's a pleasure to talk to you. I don't sit around thinking about myself and my movies very often. So you took me down a nice memory lane, and happy to share with you and whoever might be listening.
Thanks for the inspiration. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to scroll through the list of people who sent me a message, and one of these people will be a lucky winner, and they'll get to attend a podcast live with one of my guests, meet them, shake their hand, ask them a few questions, or else if they're out of town, out of state, or out of the country, we'll Skype them in or FaceTime them or anything like that so they can be there. Why not? So let me look here randomly and pick somebody. All right, landing on Sky Girl BC, August 8th, 2019. Heading reads, an experience, 5 stars. They wrote, felt like an experience listening, really teaching me a lot about the industry, even in just one episode. Thank you so much, Sky Girl BC. You are a winner. And that wraps up our podcast.
I just wanted to thank my incredible partners, starting with AquaTrue, the revolutionary miniature countertop water purification system that works straight out of the box. Plug it in, fill it with tap water, and immediately turn your faucet into your favorite bottled water for pennies. You can get $100 off when you go to industrystandardwater.com and just type in the promo code Barry and start enjoying the best water you've ever had, and never buy another bottle of water again. And I Killed JFK, the groundbreaking film about the only living person who admitted to killing Kennedy. Go to IKilledJFK.com, buy the film and the rare interviews with five of the last living experts, and I guarantee it'll change your mind about what happened that day. And the Air Doctor, the innovative portable air purification system which will change your overall quality of life. It instantly removes dust, pet hair, mold, pollen, flu viruses, and other contaminants circulating in your home. Normally $600, and if you don't believe me, check Amazon right now. But for a limited time, I can offer you 50% off. That's a $300 savings. Just go to airdoctorpro.com, type in the promo code Barry, and start breathing the cleanest and healthiest air in the world. And here's a preview of the next very special episode.
Caitlyn Jenner.
You have to live your life with a happy soul, you know? And that's really hard to do sometimes. And whatever your stuff may be, it could be drinking, alcohol, whatever, you know. Every time you do something like that, it affects a lot of people. And do your best to live your life authentically. I mean, it's the only way to go.
As always, this has been Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. And if you like the show, tell all your friends. And if you don't like the show, tell all your friends.
You get all the money, drive that fancy car, all the people love you, cause you're going far. Life is for the dreamers, they have all to gain, it's never quite over, so it all feels the same. You pick your own poison, dig your own grave down in the valley. A fortune.
Thank you for listening to Industry Standard with Barry Katz. If you'd like more info on our schedule of new episodes or how to reach Barry through Twitter, Facebook, or email, go to BarryKatz.com. Before you leave, please take a moment to subscribe to our podcast, leave a comment, and rate it, even if you think it blows. Thank you for your support, and have a great day.